We need to get the people off the rig. We may not be able to hold the rig. The rig might be going over. The foreman's desperate cry crackled over the emergency radio, his voice barely audible over the deafening storm. The Ocean Ranger, once a towering fortress in the sea, was under siege. Huge waves crashed against it from all sides as frigid water poured in. In the chaos, the men fought for life jackets, their only hope for survival, as others made a more desperate choice, leaping from the gigantic oil rig into the ocean below. Those left aboard watched and were faced with a terrifying reality. Would they soon be meeting the same fate? Only a few hours earlier, the Ocean Ranger had been standing upright in the sea. Now the gigantic oil rig was leaning dangerously far over, tilting closer and closer to the roaring waves, as if the ocean itself was determined to pull the enormous vessel under the inky black surface. How did it all go so wrong? How did this unstoppable force of engineering become a death trap? And with time running out, could anyone survive the rig's final moments? They thought it was unsinkable. Even though the crew aboard all called it a rig, the Ocean Ranger was technically a self-propelled drilling platform designed to be semi-submersible. At the time, it was by far the largest platform of its kind ever built, weighing 25,000 tons, or 28,000 short tons, and standing at roughly the height of a 33-story building. While it towered over the crew aboard the main deck, almost an entire third of the Ocean Ranger itself was concealed deep beneath the water. 80 feet below the waves were a pair of 400-foot pontoons, equipped with ballast tanks that could be filled with water to keep the rig afloat in harsh seas. In theory, it should have been able to take whatever the ocean threw at it, unsinkable, or so they thought. They were drilling in the Grand Banks of Newfoundland, 166 miles or 267 kilometers away from the Canadian mainland. The rig was burrowing 1,500 feet deep into the oil and natural gas reserves below the ocean floor. It was in an area known for dangerous weather, particularly in the winter months. The crew aboard the Ocean Ranger had trusted that the rig would be enough to protect them from the sheer force of the sea. But that trust would offer them little protection against the combined forces of the elements, like opening an umbrella to fend off a hurricane. February 14, 1982. That morning, the crew listened to the weather forecasts, the reporters warning that a harsh winter storm with winds of 90 knots and waves of up to 37 feet was rolling toward the Grand Banks, thanks to a large cyclone further out in the Atlantic. But none of them worried all that much. The rig was designed to withstand those weather conditions, so nobody saw any immediate cause for concern. Most of the crew had even seen it standing firm against powerful waves and storms before. The harsh winter weather conditions near the Grand Banks hadn't been understated to the crew of hardened oilmen. But still, not one of them aboard had any reason to believe that this next storm would be any different than the last. After all, why would it? Famous last words. The crew still had to prepare the rig and everyone aboard for the incoming storm. Some were responsible for finding any equipment that was likely to be carried overboard by the fearsome winds and securing it in place. Others were tasked with meticulously checking that weather-tight portholes and doors were properly sealed. Then, most critical of all was the need to manage the ballast tanks below. The ballast control system mediated the amount of seawater going into or out of the tanks, meaning they could maintain the Ocean Ranger's buoyancy in response to the wild, unruly waters below. If that failed, they were all as good as dead. But the crew knows that the Ranger is a sturdy beast. It's designed to withstand 110-foot-tall waves and wind speeds of up to 100 knots. Despite how intense this incoming storm was reported to be, it does little to deter the crew from going about their day-to-day duties after the appropriate safety measures have been taken. But they wouldn't be nearly enough in the face of the storm that was approaching. Little did any of the crew know, the storm would bring waves that would decimate all of the Ocean Ranger's defenses. Whether driven by their belief that the Ocean Ranger could withstand the weather, or out of fear of reprisals from their superiors at Odeco Inc. and Mobil if they abandoned their station, the crew persevered. As the long stormy night rolled on, conditions in the rig made it harder to work. The rain was bad enough, working in tandem with the fierce winds of 80 knots or 92 miles per hour to freeze the men to the bone. It was dark out at sea, even with the lights aboard the Ranger. Visibility was poor. Drilling quickly became an uphill battle. The rig's systems required constant monitoring, most crucially the ballast control system, and the crew was spread dangerously thin. Before long, the waves battering the Ocean Ranger began to climb, increasing in height and gradually pushing the limits of what the rig could withstand. The crew was in constant radio communication with the shore, as well as other rigs in the area too, keeping them all up to speed on the situation out at sea while the drilling continued. 7:15 p.m. A radio transmission reached the Sedco 706. The crew aboard the neighboring oil platform overheard some internal communications from the Ocean Ranger, reporting that the waves were getting bigger, with some being between 55 and 65 feet. There was also something about a broken porthole and water seeping into the rig itself. Only moments before, a rogue wave had come rolling toward the Ocean Ranger, one far larger and stronger than the others in the storm. The oil rig had already been pushed to its limits, bombarded by increasingly powerful waves, and this was the one that hit it the hardest. The wave directly struck the side of the Ocean Ranger with such force that it shattered one of the porthole windows, one that just so happened to be in the ballast control room. A huge rush of icy water surged into one of the most essential rooms of the entire rig, home to the system that was vital for keeping the Ocean Ranger stable. Each subsequent wave that hit the rig now had a way in. The impending flood quickly destroyed the tech in the ballast control room. The porthole wasn't a large opening, but it was big enough for seawater to gush inside with each big wave. The porthole itself was only 25 feet from the ocean surface. Any wave higher than that was bringing more and more water aboard. 9 p.m. The radio operator aboard the nearby Sedco oil platform overheard another transmission from the Ocean Ranger. Their crew says there's something seriously wrong with their rig's ballast control valves. They now seem to be opening and closing of their own accord. Back on the Ocean Ranger, the furious waters and now inoperable ballast tanks below caused the whole rig to list and tilt violently beneath the crew's feet. There was one hope, a way to manually control the ballast tanks. But the storm was only getting worse. Beneath the ocean surface, more water floods the forward chain lockers, located in the front-facing support columns for the rig. Thanks to the broken porthole in the ballast control room and the Ocean Ranger tilting forward, the forward chain lockers let in enough water that the corner support columns begin to flood. The seawater levels inside the rig begin to climb, eventually spilling out onto the upper deck. Splashes underfoot become ankle deep. Then they rose to the knee, crewmen needing to wade through rising water. The moment that the flooding spread to the oil platform, it looked like the vessel would capsize, plunging everyone on board under the icy depths of the storm-frenzied sea. Meanwhile, the crew inside the ballast control room were still battling the elements while trying to stabilize the Ocean Ranger. But water wasn't the only problem. Not one of them had been trained properly. There had been a startling lack of crew training for those aboard the Ocean Ranger. The crew had no idea how to operate the ballast control system, even without the added panic of the storm and the water disrupting the system. While trying to fix the problem, the crew aboard the Ocean Ranger had accidentally increased the forward list of the rig, making the situation far, far worse. 12:52 a.m., the early hours of February 15, 1982. The Ocean Ranger broadcast a mayday, reporting that their platform was listing badly. An emergency vessel standing by, the MV Seaforth Highlander, sailed out to assist. Within 10 minutes of the alarming message hitting the airwaves, helicopters owned by Mobil and the Canadian Coast Guard were in the air, heading toward the rig. Hospitals in St. John's on the mainland were told to be on standby. Out at sea, despite help being on the way, the bow of the Ocean Ranger continued to dip lower, while at the same time, the stern of the rig was raised up out of the water. The ballast control system was located in the stern, meaning that those inside were losing their footing and risking serious injury as the room around them started to tilt. To make matters worse, the pumps used to fill the ballast tanks with water didn't have sufficient power to send the water up such a steep incline now that the stern was rising out of the water. Each hour, the list of the Ocean Ranger got worse, looking more and more like the crew were either going to need to abandon the rig or die aboard it. So the call was made, and emergency procedures were quickly underway. All drilling operations had already been halted, but it was now time to start seriously considering a full-scale evacuation of the Ocean Ranger. Crew members raced up and down the lengths of the listing rig to shut down any systems that weren't deemed essential. Everyone had to turn their focus toward crisis management. But as if the severity of the storm, malfunctioning equipment, and the increasing tilt of the platform weren't enough to contend with, just like when it came to regaining control of the ballast system, the company hadn't provided the crew with formal training in the safety procedures for the Ocean Ranger, including evacuation procedures. They were on their own, working off what experience they had with emergencies like this, which was limited at best, and not helped by the safety features aboard the Ocean Ranger being inadequate as well. The standby vessels on their way to help had also been given no safety protocols to follow, which would mean they'd be unable to rescue any crew members that successfully evacuated aboard lifeboats. The Canadian Coast Guard, on their way to aid the crew of the Ocean Ranger, exercised their right to sequester other boats to assist in an emergency, enlisting the support of the MV Boltentor and MV Norditor. These were standby vessels for the Sedco 706 and another nearby platform, Zapata Uglend, respectively. However, those boats, along with the MV Seaforth Highlander, had to fight against the same elements that were battering the Ocean Ranger. The high winds and turbulent waters were prohibiting safe approach for the boats, making it just as big of a risk to the lives of the rescue teams as the crew they were sailing out to assist. Still, while the crew aboard were trying desperately to find an exit strategy, the support vessels were braving the violent stormy waters. They had every intention of reaching the unstable platform and evacuating the crew on board, but the harsh conditions were making it all the more challenging. But the ongoing storm wasn't the only factor hindering the rescue attempts. The standby vessels were still woefully ill-equipped for the task, and hadn't been properly configured to rescue Ocean Ranger crew members if they managed to make their way off the rig and into the icy seas below. 1:30 a.m. The final message from the Ocean Ranger was transmitted. "There will be no further radio communications from Ocean Ranger," comes the foreboding broadcast from the radio operator. "We are going to lifeboat stations." Afterward, the support vessels could hear nothing. The other platforms listening in for radio chatter only received static. The Ocean Ranger had gone silent. Aboard the rig, the crew was in the midst of an evacuation attempt. It wasn't as simple as hopping into a lifeboat and sailing to the safety of the shore. It was a frenzy, scores of people clamoring to get off the sinking rig. Many were either trying to barge their way to being aboard one of the first lifeboats, or were desperately gathering up any essential survival gear they could carry. Some were putting the rest of the crew before themselves and ensuring that the life jackets had been passed out among the men, fastening and securing them ready to go. Others were trying desperately to ready the lifeboats for departure, as the Ocean Ranger listed and tilted more and more around them. Almost as horrifying as the rig tilting all around them was the knowledge among some crew that even if they made it off the Ocean Ranger, there was a reason that evacuation was a last resort. A lifeboat was not a ticket to safety. It was just an exchange, swapping a huge vessel that had already been ravaged by the sea for a tiny one that could just as easily be swept away by the waves. Even getting free from the Ocean Ranger, the crewmen still would be at the mercy of the elements, thrown about on the water while huddled together in the hopes that one of the rescue teams would both see them and be able to reach them in the storm. While some crew tried desperately to prepare for evacuation with little preparation or training to equip them for an emergency like this, others were starting to panic. Tensions were climbing. Some of the men were still confused as to what had happened, while others were anxious to abandon the Ocean Ranger before the rig became their watery tomb. But not one of them was ignorant of the terrifying, inescapable truth. All of their lives were at stake. The lifeboats aboard the Ocean Ranger, like many, were designed to launch in adverse and extreme conditions, but not many are intended to launch at the angle the oil platform was now listing. In particular, the lifeboats aboard the Ocean Ranger relied on gravity to drop directly down into the water, meaning the rig needed to be relatively level, which it certainly was not anymore. But in a minor miracle, one of the lifeboats was able to successfully launch, containing up to 36 members of the crew, all jammed inside the tiny vessel. Sometime after the lifeboat had hit the water, the MV Seaforth Highlander support boat arrived in the area, only to see bodies floating in the water. There were 20 crew members at least floating in the choppy seas, according to the later reports by witnesses aboard the standby vessel. Combined with the others aboard the lifeboat, that made a total of 56 who had made it to the water one way or another. 2:21 a.m., the MV Seaforth Highlander spotted emergency flares and began moving toward one of the lifeboats. It drifted toward the standby vessel, containing a handful of the Ocean Ranger's crew members. As it pulled up alongside them, the rescue team aboard the Seaforth was able to hurriedly throw lines to the lifeboat and started to pull it closer through the ocean. But the storm was still swirling the waters into a maelstrom, and before anyone could be helped out of the lifeboat and brought aboard the Seaforth Highlander, the small vessel was hammered hard against the hull of the support vessel. More heavy waves caused the line to suddenly snap and overturn the lifeboat. It capsized in the freezing North Atlantic waters, leaving the few men clambering out of the lifeboat now clinging to its sides for dear life, soaked and chilled to the bone, their hands numb from the icy water. The MV Seaforth Highlander fought through the swelling waves to reach the men, but it was already too late. By the time the boat reached them, the cold had already taken them. Only one of the Ocean Ranger crew was seen in a bright orange life jacket. The Seaforth Highlander almost chopped him to pieces with its propellers as it tried moving into position to save him. The rescue crew aboard hurled a grappling hook into the water, attempting to pull the man aboard. Even though it hooked onto his life jacket, the man soon slipped out of sight beneath the water. Desperately trying to save someone, anyone, from the Ocean Ranger, the rescue team aboard the Seaforth realized they couldn't pull someone from waters as violent as these, the towering waves making it dangerous to attempt to save any of the men drowning or freezing to death. As if battling with the tall icy waves and powerful winds whipped up by the storm wasn't hard enough, the standby vessels just hadn't been equipped for an emergency of this scale. 2:30 a.m. The Coast Guard and mobile-owned rescue helicopters had arrived. Much like the standby vessels, they struggled to approach, thanks to the severity of the storm. One made its way to hover over the first man that the crew spotted and lowered a rescuer down to pluck the Ocean Ranger crewman from the sea, but he was already dead. The choppers battled against the wind speeds of 90 miles per hour, but even with the struggle to stay airborne in those conditions, the thrashing of the sea made it nearly impossible to recover bodies from the waters below. Instead, the best that the helicopters could do was try to guide the support ships toward the bodies that were floating through the ocean. But trying to get closer, it was clear to the crews aboard the Seaforth Highlander and the other sequestered boats that they were putting themselves in harm's way. The men out on the deck trying to recover the bodies risked being knocked overboard themselves by the freezing cold waves, potentially joining the Ocean Ranger's crew in their grim fate. 2:45 a.m. Another of the rescue teams reported that they could see the Ocean Ranger. The platform was still listing heavily, waves crashing over onto the main deck, which should have been standing high above the sea level. From a distance, there didn't look to be anyone left on board, and all the lifeboats were gone. They could have been swept up by the storm, or perhaps the remaining crew had managed to launch them. Continuing to search the waters, the standby vessels and the helicopters working in tandem could find two more of the lifeboats and a handful of the inflatable life rafts from the Ocean Ranger. Each one had no one on board. One of the boats found one lifeboat that was carrying the bodies of several more crew members inside, but the rescue crew were unable to recover it, thanks to the storm. That lifeboat was never seen again. By the time the rescue helicopters had arrived, it was already too late. They could do little more than provide a futile gesture of assisting the boats below, but they were having just as hard of a time navigating through the stormy weather. Each and every member of the Ocean Ranger's crew was dead. Those who made it off the rig had either succumbed to hypothermia or drowned, and those who didn't, if they had survived aboard the capsizing platform, likely didn't live for very much longer. The Ocean Ranger was listing so severely that it was no longer stable. 3:13 a.m. The Ocean Ranger oil rig capsized completely and disappeared beneath the waterline, gone from sight and plummeting down to the bottom of the ocean. The disaster was finally over, and no one had survived. Despite the numerous attempts by standby vessels and helicopters to rescue crewmen from the water, not one succeeded. The wave that started it all by crashing through the Ocean Ranger's porthole and damaging the ballast control system had taken 84 lives, every single member of the crew. In the immediate aftermath of the disaster, the search and rescue operation had now become a recovery mission. Over the next few days, of the 84 crew members on board, only 22 of the bodies were recovered from the North Atlantic Ocean and brought to Pier 17 Harbor. A few days later, debris from the Ocean Ranger and the crew's personal effects washed up on the shores of Newfoundland. Once the storm out in the North Atlantic had subsided, the combined forces of the Canadian military and the United States Coast Guard conducted an extensive search for whatever was still left of the Ocean Ranger. Over several weeks after the sinking, they used sonar to sweep the surrounding area of the ocean the platform had gone down in. The wreckage was eventually found almost 500 feet to the southeast of the wellhead it had been operating in before the storm hit. The main structure of the Ocean Ranger lay 260 feet below the water on the ocean floor, surrounded by its own debris, everything that had been broken off during the storm, including the oil rig's derrick and the cranes on board, now lay strewn about like bones on the seabed. Determining that the ruins of the Ocean Ranger were resting shallow enough to be a hazard to marine life and seafaring vessels alike, the sunken wreckage was floated and towed toward deeper waters, where it was allowed to sink once more, just another watery grave. Now check out Why is Titanic Still at the Bottom of the Ocean? Or watch this instead.